Okay. You are now being recorded. Anyway, yeah, the usual stuff. Be nice, be professional. IPR guidelines for IETF apply. And there are the links for the our newly set up GitHub for the ASDF group and also for the notes for this meeting. And then I need to post there. Here is the full note wall, which, yeah, you know by heart. Here is the agenda for today. Introduction, administrative stuff, some agenda bashing. We'll then go through the status update for the ASDF group, look at the result of the adoption call, and then head on to the SDF 1.1 features. So are there anything people want to add to the agenda here?
If we had more of a consensus, I would ask us to more of a quorum. I would ask, suggest maybe we should think about the post IETF 109 schedule, a virtual interim schedule.
Good point.
Very good point. Ask, but it's usually easier to discuss. So I just say, but we don't have the quorum, so we'll go back to doodle anyway.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. I think we need to do that at the, we have some slides on that later on, but yeah.
Yeah,
one, it's a good point.
One data point is that 1DM is going to a biweekly scheme, so maybe you want to use the other slot, but yeah, we can rule that out.
By the way, is someone taking notes?
Yes, I'm trying to take notes. But
good, thank you.
I haven't said anything, so.
No. Of course not, but just need to take a note taker. Good. Then we move on with this agenda. Status update, the good stuff. We have been chartered as a working group, so we're now up and running. And this is the first official meeting. We did have an official meeting before we were chartered, but now we are official and up and running. And the plans going forward is to have a virtual interim today to look at the adoption of the first draft and the content going into that. And then our next meeting parts will be, or meeting events will be at 109 at the hackathon. We have been discussing with the 1DM group and also in here that we should have a meeting to, we should somehow during the hackathon work a bit more on some features and a number of, a list of other sort of SDF related things, part of the Wishy hackathon group. I don't think we have scheduled any time for that yet. But we should do that. And then for IETF 109, oh, here I forgot to update. We have a slot scheduled on Tuesday, I think.
Tuesday at 0900 UTC.
Yes. that's, we are moving along there. That's good. And then activities since last meeting, well, since the unofficial meeting, I was asked to present, or we were asked to present this ASDF work to the OMA SpecWorks, the MSC group, the Lightweight MTM group, and so I did so on a week ago. And they were quite interested in this work. I told them to join. They apparently haven't so far, but I told them to join anyway. Either an IETF or in the 1DM group. So so this is, for the record, is slightly different than, even if like with M2M and IPSO are closely related, they are working with different data models. These were on the device management side. Yes, that was the status update. We'll come to the adoption call in a moment. Then we had a list on working group processes. just to, since we're now sort of official group, we'll, as always, ensure to make the decisions on the mailing list, and there's a list link to the list. We do our work on GitHub, and there's a link to the GitHub page. The SDF spec will be migrated. It actually has been migrated already earlier today. So the SDF spec is already on GitHub, on our GitHub page. And I mean, the idea is to use the issue tracker for issues and new features, including both new features and sort of fixes, and do PRs towards the main spec. So this is pretty standard work. We are looking beyond 109. We'll try to run regular interims between the virtual physical meetings, and we will send out the doodle for finding a meeting time. Or I mean, had we been more, we could have discussed it, but we will be following that up in the near future. And then finally, from a process perspective, one of the points here, one of the ideas here is to, as we go along, we will do intermediate implementation drafts of SDF available. And the reason for that, as we discussed this in the chartering process, was to have stable specs that could be used by the one data model folks and others as kind of update target for tool chains and so on. So how we actually mark this is to be decided, but the intent is to have semi-regular, at least, drafts of this kind as we move along to the final RFC. Yeah, any questions on that? Nope. So, to the big point of today, the first big point of today, the call for adoption on SDF 1.0 draft. And this was sent out, the call for adoption was sent out asking for objections on October 20th. And to my, I haven't seen any objections raised so far. Are there any final objections that somebody wants to raise here before we adopt this draft going forward? I hear none. Then I think we can say that draft is now adopted into the ASDF working group, and so it's now an ASDF draft. Great, that's very good. There should be some kind of cheering music here, but that means we have our first milestone put in place, adopting that draft. Great. And we will send out the confirming mail on the mailing list as well. So now I see Alan joining as well. Hi, Alan. Welcome. Great. Ready.
Paul, did you
say somebody? Alan Sunaway.
Okay, well, he's maybe getting audio and maybe not, but there we go. Keep going.
Hey guys, I am getting audio. Sorry about that.
Okay, no problem. Welcome, Alan. We are moving along in the slides here. So with that, we have our first adopted draft in the group, which means that we can move on to SDF 1.1. Look at what we want to have in place for SDF 1.1. And there are currently four new features proposed And Karsten has put together some slides to describe those features. So do you want to take over driving the slides, Karsten, or?
Next slide, please.
Okay, Karsten, go ahead. So
we have two issues that actually, if you start looking closer, are rather related. So we have found that the enum mechanism we have in SDF 1.0 is too limiting. And we also have a discussion of the need for general choices, something that's done with anyof in JSON schema org. And if you look at the examples, actually there isn't that much of a difference between the two. So the main perceived difference may be that these look very different in JSON schema org, but actually these are just ways to express choices. And now what is the point of having a choice? Usually we have different states or different settings that we start describing by giving them string names like on and off or enabled and paid for and whatever. And one question that came up in the discussion was, how do these text string names map to semantic tags on one end, and how do they map to implementation level entities that often are integers? So let's look at a number of examples. Next slide, please. So this is the canonical example. I think that's one of Michael Costa's examples, where we have an SDF property called state, and that is essentially a choice between on and off. Of course, you could simply describe with a Boolean, but here we chose to describe it with two named alternatives, one called on, one called off. And we also have a way to put a description there. So all this would have been a little bit more difficult by just using a Boolean. And of course, you might also have a third thing in there, standby, heating up, whatever. So it's a natural thing that these enums actually can be extended over time. So starting with Boolean gives you a somewhat suboptimal basis for further extensions. So we do have these comments. We haven't really talked about how we are going to do semantic tagging. So that's really one thing we have to discuss. But also, next slide, there are more complicated examples. Oh, that's getting a bit small. You know that you can zoom in your WebEx clients. Here we have an SDF property called startup current level, and this is supposed to be the level of current that the device that flows through the device during startup. And this is interestingly a choice between the choice and a number. So the number is something in the range between 1 and 254, and probably an integer, though that it doesn't say so. And the other one says it's another choice, which this time is not expressed using any of, but using SDF enum, that has a minimum device value permitted and a set to previous value state. Interestingly, it doesn't have a maximum device value permitted, which I think would be the obvious thing to add here. And a middle value would be another obvious thing to add, and so on. So the enum, again, would likely be want to be extensible. But what we can see here is that this is putting in some cases that are numeric in nature. I have no idea how currents are specified with numbers between 1 and 254, but you could imagine that, and the description could describe this in more detail. So this is an actual number meant to be a number on the information model level. And then there are two cases which are also expressed by numbers just because they are in some ecosystem standard. And so we have a separate number for minimum device value permitted and a separate number for set to previous value. Again, the labels are not semantic, but at least it's possible to understand them as a reader. And the ability to set integers here may be a bug or a feature, so that people are debating that. Obviously, if everybody is using the same numbers here, if all ecosystems are using the same number, it's a healthy way of factoring out complexity by to actually put the number here. But if the number, or actually the question whether this is even represented as a number, is ecosystem specific, then we are carrying some baggage here in the common information model that actually doesn't transfer over to the ecosystem. So that's why some think this is a bug and other think this is a feature.
Karsten,
yeah.
Is there accommodation for the fact that different ecosystems could well have completely different ways of dealing with the things, like one is the highest number or the brightest, and that one has 254 as the brightest, or different? I mean, I don't know, I can't imagine things other than integers, but maybe there are. But I guess, does that make any sense, what I'm asking?
Absolutely. So imagine an ecosystem that happens to have 255 different startup current levels. So they will be very unhappy having to map this into 254.
Right. Yeah. What are they going to do with the last number? Right. But since we're describing a particular device, that particular device would typically live in one ecosystem.
Yes.
And so, if it's translated into a different ecosystem, and that other ecosystem can only go to 254, then, or does it just, like, I'm trying to understand if the end result is that the controller in the middle has to do some mapping, like of 1 to 255 to 1 to 254, as you just described, with some knowledge of the two sides, or is there some other what exactly is imagined for that controller, and does the standard have something to say about how the mapping between ecosystems could occur? Maybe I should ask this to Ari, who I guess has done a bunch of mapping code already.
Well, I can throw in one reflection here. One thing, well, SDF can be used for two different things. One is kind of like describing a specific ecosystem thing, I mean, kind of quite accurately. And then also specifying these, is it consolidated models or whatever we call them nowadays, that those that have you know, much more potential for actually doing the translations. And some of these features may be more useful for one or the other use case of SDF. So yes, I can imagine you could describe an ecosystem, kind of especially legacy models, in a way that you don't get, you know, full round trip ability or like full translation between different ecosystems. But then those consolidated models would be using a more restricted set that would have more capabilities for that kind of translation. And I can imagine sometimes we're gonna hit some cases where, you know, not all things are translatable to all ecosystems, or you may need to do, you know, human knowledge needed, so it's not fully automated translation. But I guess in practice, we'll see where the boundaries between each of the use cases will settle when we have more ecosystems where we do automated translation. Now we have just a few we have experience from.
So one description language I know from a project we had in Germany a while ago with a German manufacturer, they actually have a linear transformation as a standard description element they can use. So they would probably say this is a number between 0 and 1, a floating point number, and we just define in our mapping file a linear transformation of that number into the range 1 to 254. So that doesn't tell you how to handle rounding errors, but it's a very flexible way to handle this situation. And it puts as little as possible knowledge about the specific ecosystems into the common model.
I think that makes a lot of sense. To do it that way, to have the kind of, what I said, translation hints in the information model.
Yeah, the problem with these mapping schemes is that they tend to grow. So in 94, I wrote a paper in which I argued that any extension language is inevitably going to grow to a Turing equivalent language, and that's probably exactly what we don't want to happen here. So I think we have to look at the landscape here and see, is there a reasonable set of things that we actually can do in these mapping rules, so we can rest on our laurels there and make the actual common model is extremely simple.
I agree. We do have at some point the sort of the if we want to translate back and forth to the various ecosystems, we could. A way to measure, right, if your translation is simple or not. That's more of an engineering problem to solve, to make it simple, rather than a theoretical, try to solve every problem.
There are other cases where actually there is an industry-wide consensus on how to map the numbers. So at least until a few years ago, you knew that the color value was something between 0 and 255, and that would describe a lot of situations. So I think we want to keep the freedom to actually use something like that in the converged data models, but we also probably don't want to put too much mapping information into the converged models, but these should be in the mappings that come with the converged models for each ecosystem.
Mm. Mm.
Okay, but what I really wanted to show in this example was that there are two constructs here. One is called AnyOf, and the other one is called SDF Enum. And really the only thing that differs between them is that in one case, it's described by an array with unnamed entries, and in the other case, it's described by a map with named entries, and that's the kind of unnecessary choice that you definitely don't want to have in a specification language. So it should either always be an array, and I think that has clear disadvantages, or it should always be a map, but we shouldn't have both. Next slide. So Michael Costa finally added another example, and that's in his now in his way of writing JSON. So imagine that there are quotes and colons and other things in there, but I think you can kind of guess what he's trying to do there. So he has a property here that has a choice between three cases. The cases are actually labeled, but the label is in the alternative. It's not a label given by the choice to the alternative. It's in the alternative. And all three are numbers, and they have certain ranges. And this essentially could be modeled in very different ways. But this is, of course, one way to model a range of numbers where subranges have specific semantics, like warm, neutral, and cool, and so on. So I don't know how realistic this example is, but it's certainly something that we should be able to do. And again, I would argue for putting the labels in front of the alternatives, so you actually can reference a type from somewhere else. And in that case, it's actually also not strictly necessary for the alternatives to be non-overlapping in their values, because you actually have the label there. So this is a little bit of a trickier using non-overlapping number ranges to encode which choice was made. So on the next slide, you can see how I would have written it. So the label doesn't become part of the type. It's part of the choice. So this is still missing a number of things here. This is not my actual proposal, because it doesn't say that this is a choice. That's one problem. And the other problem is that it doesn't really indicate optionality. We currently have this ugly required thing. But let's keep it at that. So I think this is the rough direction we should be going in. So in the end, both Enum and any of proposal move into this single way of doing a choice. So people who import JSON schema org models would have to translate any offs and enums into this common scheme, and vice versa. Okay, so this is my view of the choice situation. Are there any more questions on the choice?
I actually have a question. Yeah, I mean, it might be because I've been out of the discussions for a while. So can you actually remind me, what are we exactly trying to express here? So is this a property that has a numeric value, and then we have some metadata about that value, or what are we actually trying to do here?
In this example?
Yes.
Yeah, that's why I said it's maybe not exactly the example we want to use for this, but it's one in the issue right now. The specification there doesn't really say what the point of that number is. So I cannot answer that question for you.
Okay, so should ask with Michael.
Yeah, but I think the criticism here could be this could be a number that just happens to encode two values, the composition of two values. And one is the warm, neutral, cool choice, and one is a number between 0 and 85 within that choice.
Okay.
So if that is what is meant, then you probably don't want to use this, but you want to use composition.
Yes, that's what I was thinking.
But this was the use case that came from Zigbee, right?
I don't know.
Or?
Yeah. Well, okay. I mean, I can ask Ken when we have Koster with us. I guess he can explain the use case background here. Okay. Thanks.
Okay. So, where are we now? I mean, what should we be doing with this? Can you write up a more proposal for this, and then we can.
That is the direction, and the next step would be to come up with a concrete proposal, so we can see how that proposal would answer all the little detailed questions that are still open in the examples.
Yeah, and also maybe look at the, what you say, inventory of the existing ecosystems and what they want to do with this.
Absolutely.
I mean, figure out how big problem this is. Okay, but good. I mean, thank you about that. But you think you can do that draft or that text for that?
Wouldn't mind having several proposals, but I can definitely. I'm not going to write the text first. I'm going to write the examples first, and then works. We can see whether we like that and whether it's worth generating the text for that.
Maybe, well, this sounds like something for the hackathon, right? To work
probably,
on.
Probably make good progress there.
Yeah. Perfect.
So the
anymore
doing it in the hackathon would be that people could then go ahead and write the converters for their ecosystems and see whether it actually works or not. And we are not doing this on a clean table, but with the implementations in mind.
Yep. Okay, any more comments or questions around this topic, choice? Then we move along.
Okay, the second issue is that we were a bit lazy when we did 1.0 and did not actually say how to compose types out of components. So this time, this is not a choice. It's actually putting in all the components into a more complex type. And it has been called complex types before, but I think that's not specific enough. So let's talk about composing types out of components. And that's the issue number four. And the ugly thing is that we can do this for some cases already in SDF 1.0, in particular for actions and events in a slightly weird way, but we cannot do this for properties right now. So that definitely needs to be fixed. And again, we don't have a good way to describe optionality. So we are doing this with SDF required at the moment. But the main reason for that is simply that we don't have a syntactic place to put in the optionality. There are, again, two ways of doing this. One is to say, like the current 1.0 does, this action has the following three types as parameters. That has a problem in that there is no way to actually name the parameter. So when you put in something like a color component value, you don't know whether that's actually red, green, or blue. Or we could actually give them names, just as I've been arguing before, that we should be giving choices, giving the alternatives in a choice names. I'm arguing that we should give the components in a composite type names. So I think that that's pretty straightforward and kind of obvious. The other question that has come up is, do we stop at composing types, which is something that we definitely understand how to do, or do we actually want to compose affordances? So should it be possible to take two properties and make a third property out of that? Some ecosystems have something like batch requests or aggregate values and so on. And that would be able to write models that use these. Next slide. So the easy part is in that example. Let's say we have a property called compound one that actually is the value of which is actually built out of two data items. Then we could specify it using a syntax like this. This is actually out of the issue. So Michael proposed using SDF data for this. Another way would be to reuse the term object like it's used in JSON schema.org. But we would probably give it a little bit different semantics. So maybe even coming up with a third name would be possible. So what's magenta in this slide is data schema. So it looks like a JSON schema.org schema. And the green thing is the composite schema that is built out of these two elementary schemas. So we have a type at the end that has two fields called element one and element two, and these are of type number and string. So this is kind of obvious. The only thing that's missing here is optionality and maybe even repeatability, because we can always put in an array if we want repeatability, so maybe we don't need that. But optionality is something that often is desirable. And we could, of course, do the same thing we do for repeatability and invent an optional syntax for saying something is optional. So I think apart from the optionality point, this can be written up pretty easily, and I think people should be happy with that until they run into the more complex examples. Any comment on that?
I think this looks good. I think it's, as long as it covers the basic OCF use cases and Walter is happy, I guess. That should be the first sort of objective, I guess.
Yep.
Apart from that, so that can set the level of complexity that is needed here. Unless we see something more difficult elsewhere, I don't know. But,
I actually already commented on this in GitHub, and I think like the requirement that I think is important here on our design is that we're able to flatten the compound structures for those ecosystems that don't have the compound at least right now. Like for example, in IPSO models, what we can do is refer to another object from an object, and then I would basically turn that SDF data into another object that I'm referring to from this property to get the compound effect. And I think it is with this kind of design that should work out rather straightforwardly, but we'll have to, you know, give it a try on the translator. I think the key thing is that we name those elements like we do here. That should do the trick.
Is that reference a specification level trick, or is that something you see on the wire with IPSO?
You see it on the wire. Basically, there's there's the property gives you the new object and the object ID, instance ID. The object ID and instance ID you should look up. So yeah, it actually works in the wire.
Yeah, so maybe you could put an example somewhere that shows how this is done in IBSO, so we can look at how to do this at the SDF level.
Mm-hmm. Yep, makes sense. It may take a while for me to get to that, but I'll look into it.
Sorry, I'm confused by what the consensus is here. Maybe there wasn't one. Maybe we didn't get to it.
Well, this is what I'm hearing. I think this proposal tentatively makes sense, but we'll give it a try on the actual code.
Yeah, I think that the proposal still needs to be written up, so it's hard to have consensus on something that isn't written up. But again, I think we have a direction that we can use for writing it up, and we should use the hackathon to actually try it out. Okay, next slide. So how do we share elements of a specification both within the specification and between specifications? That's issue number three. We have a bit of an answer to that. So the current spec says how to use JSON pointers to do this, but we haven't really tested that. So we are not quite sure how we would run the management of that space, and we have to find that out. Before we can go into the details, we probably have to decide what can we actually reference. In STF 1.0, that's always a data type, and we essentially only can reference data types that are defined in an SDF data. So the reference is a universal construct, so it could be used for referencing something else, but I don't think we provide the semantics for what that would mean. So we probably have to think about the need to reference and then maybe combine, so we go back to the composition issue, entire affordances. And another interesting thing about references is that you sometimes want to have something that is very much like something else, but not exactly like it. So there may be a desire to alter a referenced type or affordance. And actually 1.0 has something there, but again, that's pretty much untested. So we need to find out whether that actually makes sense in the long run. Next slide. So the example that is in the document right now is a type definition for something called length, and that's a number that cannot be negative, and it's in units of meter, and there is a description here which obviously is a bit short. So there may be semantic tags and other things there as well. And then we might have something like a cable length somewhere that says, oh, I'm almost but not entirely like a length, but my minimum actually is 0.05. So that's a reference that actually alters the definition, or makes a copy of a definition and then goes ahead and alters that. So it's a subtype in some way. And of course, obvious thing that comes up here, cables must at least be 5 centimeters. Is that something that adds to the description in the base, or is it something that overrides that? We probably want to have a very simple way of doing this so it doesn't become too complicated. So that's what we have, and there are a few things that need to be clarified, but I think it's pretty solid the way it is. And now in the next slide, we actually have an SDF property that uses a data type and modifies it. So we have an unnamed data type that is then used for the property cable length. And I think that that's again something that, that should be possible. And I think it poses essentially the same question that the previous slide does. So the difference between SDF data and SDF property is that data just defines a data type, while property actually defines not just the data type, but also declares an affordance that is of this data type. So next slide. Now, what we have defined in 1.0, what haven't exercised, is an import-export system. So when we have one specification that defines a length type and does this in a namespace that is called moo inside the specification, and that namespace is identified as default namespace, then essentially this the yellow specification specifies that goes into https://example.com/sdf-data/length. And from a different specification, the white one here, we can reference it by giving the namespace a local name, which need not be the same one. So it's not moo, but foo in this example. And then by using foo colon slash SDF data slash length, we can reference that specification. So it's pretty much what was in the previous slide, but it's distributed between two specifications. And the question really is, how does the white specification actually find the specification that is filling the https://example.com. In particular, since example.com does not have a website that would give us SDF specification snippets. So the idea cannot be that we use the namespace identifiers for dereferencing such a namespace identifier and then find that somewhere, because that means we need centralized management of each namespace, and that makes it really hard to do things like experimental versions of documents, and the whole process becomes complicated when you have to give provisional specifications different namespaces, because the real one is the serious one and you cannot touch it, and so on. So we are not looking for namespace identifiers as ways to find the specification. So we need a different way of doing this, and this will probably be something like a convention. So within the playground, for instance, we could say playground specifications can only ever reference data from other playground specifications or from converged specifications. And then we would have a clear, well-delimited domain where these names are actually resolved. But we actually have to try doing it and see what happens, for instance, to the playground if we do that. And then we can decide, okay, we can keep what's in 1.0 there, or we can change it. We can easily change it because we haven't really made use of it yet. So that would be the third thing we would test at the hackathon and see whether we can factor out common parts, for instance, and make them available in separate specifications that are then found by the specifications referencing them. So this is my response to the issue 3 about references. And again, I think we have a pretty clear direction, which is trying out what we already have. And then we have to take it from there.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, I think that sounds like a way forward as well. So I wonder if we, for this, and also for the other ones, we should try to write up some, very drafty draft text about how do we think this should work, so we can test it out. First figure out examples that look nice or look correct, and then we sort of spec it, and then we implement it.
Yeah, we could do that in the issue, in the GitHub issue.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yes. Any other comments to this? Sorry.
Yeah, I think this also looks good. One thing to consider on the descriptions is we may want to have two levels of descriptions. One is that I think especially for these reusable data properties, one is kind of the generic description, and the second one is description of that thing in the context where it's used. That's something what we're currently lacking in IPSO models, but it's something I would love to have there too. That's something might be a useful feature, because it's very hard to do good generic description that fits in all the contexts nicely.
Another example of that might be helpful.
I think like one of them was a property called level. And you would like to use the same level on a dimmer and on a buzzer. And you cannot write there, this is the intensity of the light or the volume of the buzzer, because it's level. I mean, that was one of the where we struggled back in the days.
Is the intention that we could say run it at 50% of the quote level? Was that what you want to be able to do, or is there something else that I don't understand?
For example, so what the good thing about having this generic level property is that you would, when you, for example, do a UI, you would have some kind of a dial for the person to tweak, hey, I'm changing the level of this thing. And instead of having audio level and light level, different things, you could actually have them in the same, but then have kind of this additional, description that tells, hey, here it's about the light.
That's a great example, because both sound and light have nonlinear levels, usually, but the way these things are nonlinear are actually different.
Yeah, so it's really about the perception. Yeah, but anyway, that's just one thing for us to consider here. I think we're going to be running a bit low on time here.
I think we have 30 more minutes, so that we are okay on time if you want to bring up.
Okay, then I think I only marked 1 hour in my calendar. Maybe that was a mistake.
It was initially entered as 1 hour and then was extended to 90 minutes. So I noticed that some of the calendaring systems don't update when the IETF thing does, mine included.
Gotcha.
The same here.
Yeah.
But So I guess we do have a way forward here as well, right? Did you note? I mean, Ari, as Carsten said, you had a good point there. So a good example. Can you write that up in the issue as well, so we don't remember things?
I can take a note there. Yeah,
please do. Okay. Yeah.
I'm done.
That's you're done. Yep. Thank you for that. Any final questions or comments on this, the final issue here, or final feature? Nope. So with that, we have gone through the three or four, depending on how you count them, issues that are were proposed already back in 1DM days to be the sort of SDF 1.1 features and the missing bits. And I guess, I guess the next step here is to take this back, make some strawman designs or translate these examples into strawman designs and then trying to implement them, and then transform it into real spec text. I don't think we have any, for the moment at least, any other big features that are missing right now. So I think these features are a worthy components to bring in. I mean, they're complex enough to be some tool work and so needed to bring into 1.1 and have 1.1 released as a, as you talked about, this intermediate implementation draft. And then have that, try to sort of get that done. Now, of course, we are getting close to both IETF, and then after that, it's getting close to Christmas and holidays and so on. Do we dare to put out some kind of very traditional target date to get SDF 1.1 up and rolling, i.e. having solved these three or four issues? Any suggestions or points?
Well, we have a week up to the hackathon. We have a hackathon week. Nothing will happen during the IETF week. And then the week afterwards, that's Thanksgiving week, but for the Europeans among us, that's a good week to get work done. I could actually imagine that we will have a first strawman of the text by the end of November. And then we can use all of December to actually nail this down and finish it and declare it an implementation draft.
So around about the end of the year, late December, early January, would be a
well. Let's try to get it in December. Target.
Yeah, I mean, it would be great to have it out before, but let's aim for that and see what happens. Good. And of course, there is a because we only have AOB business here. There is one thing that I was thinking of, but actually forgot to put into the agenda here, which is slightly related to this, and this is, of course, that we should look at various ways of reaching out to other IoT ecosystems that are not part of 1DM for whatever reason, and if they want to sort of pitch in and have their particular ideas and so on. So any suggestions to about what ecosystems to reach out to and also sort of if we have good entry points into other ecosystems, they would be valuable to have here.
Well, I think we should delegate that mostly to Michael Koster, because he seems to have his finger in every single one. But I think that maybe OPCUA has gotten is fallen through. There's probably some other transport focused ones that maybe some Siemens people would know. I don't know. Like, in other words, I probably don't know what they are. And I don't know if the automotive space is even close to the point of having regular object models. I think they're still arguing about connectors and wires, right? So, but there may be some work there that I'm ignorant of.
Yeah, at least on the problem, I guess, with the automotive space is that every automotive player is like, they're not so good at sharing with each other internal.
That's actually why I'm suggesting is they're so bad at sharing with each other that they may actually be very interested in sharing with us.
Yeah, could right? be. I mean, yeah, could be. Yeah.
Right. So, because sharing with each other means adopting each other's protocols, which they don't want to do. But SDF kind of isn't doing that, right? So maybe it would work. Maybe there's some more presentations like the one you did last week that are would be in order. What I know of it comes from one automotive Ethernet conference I went to in February in Munich, which is where I learned that they were hyper obsessed about security but didn't really know what to do anything about it, and yet still arguing over the shape of the connectors and the logic of the wires and Ethernet versus CAN plus versus other stuff. But anyway, I pasted in the notes, I pasted the December calendar. Hearing that, you said we thought we could have all of November to nail this down. And so the question was whether there was a worth having a virtual interim in December to provide a deadline to this, or whether that made make sense to do this in January, beginning of January. We were going to go back to Doodle anyway, to the list for a regular time.
Yeah.
But I was just kind of wanting to think, well, I don't know when the 1DM calls, they were approximately this time slot. Now every 2 weeks, you're saying.
Yes.
Yeah, they were earlier. I think they... I wasn't at the meeting where the biweekly schedule was discussed, but I guess we were moving to... They were earlier at hours that were not nice to our Pacific Coast team members.
Right. Okay.
But yeah.
So I'm just suggesting one of the 7th, 14th, well, more likely the 14th or 21st might be good things. The 21st is probably over the date when people maybe start working anymore. I don't know.
So the 14th, let's make it tentative for the 14th. I say without having looked at my calendar or anything. I mean, those weeks are typically crazy, even if, well, of course, now with Corona, the activities in kids' schools are not, they are no such things.
I'm not going to any Christmas concerts either, right? So, exactly. No,
exactly. But on the 14th, and we have to call for that 2 weeks in advance. So I think we should have a, Let's say 14th for now, and okay. then and as we get beyond,
yeah.
yeah, but also as we get around the later half of November, we can see, I mean, are we getting anywhere or are we not getting anywhere? And if we are getting anywhere, then, I mean, we should roll with that. I think. Well, is that okay with people?
That's good.
Sounds good to me.
So I think we got to the end of the meeting. I will make sure that the YouTube link, when as soon as I see it reposted by the secretariat, I will make sure that gets posted into the list, and maybe some people will watch our meeting and wish to comment. Since we're so small, and we should find out, we should probably reach out to the people we expected to come, find out why they missed it, and what do we do to fail to capture their attention.
Well, we have a list of these people in the doodle. Pardon? So we can just go through the doodle and
We'll go through the doodle and there may be some other names that we missed. I will go pull up the doodle and do that. But maybe your list, your message to the 1DM list obviously was late, so I'm not on that list.
Yeah. Yeah, sorry about that.
Good. One quick question. Are we collecting already a backlog for 1.2?
Yes.
Obviously.
Well, we haven't started yet, but please, I mean, absolutely, feel free to.
I was wondering, I mean, there was some discussion in the IETF meeting when this was presented in the both about being able to add more descriptions about those affordances. I think it was something on reliability, if I remember correctly. I was wondering, was that followed up on?
The problem with that was, and that was not asked for in the charter during the charter discussion either. I think the problem with that request was to have more, to say, soft requirements like performance, reliability, and so on, included here. And given that none of the ecosystems today model those, and that I guess, I mean, it's probably a whole, I'm not saying that I mean, it would be super cool to have it there. And I mean, they also ask for things like traffic. Kind of traffic parameters or traffic dimensioning parameters and stuff. I don't think that seems like SDF needs to rely on other people defining those terms first, and then we can bring them in rather than the other way around.
Yeah. And so it would be finding the ecosystem needs for those and then bring them.
Or attaching to some other existing specifications that we find useful. If you want to do this kind of thing, Here is what the semantic markup is, and here is what the terms mean, and so on. I mean, that would make a lot of sense, but we need to have that reference first.
Good. Thanks.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay. Let me.
We're done.
So, are we done? Everybody happy? I hope. Reasonably happy at least.
Barry?
Then I guess.
I have nothing to say. You guys are doing a great startup here. Thanks.
Slow start.
Thank you.
You know, I gotta get that window open, damn it.
Part of this appeal, right?
All right, good. I'm going to end the meeting then. And we'll talk to you soon, all of you, probably in the next virtual interim, which was probably of where we'll all run to each other again anyway. Bye.
Yes. Well, I'll turn off the recording now, and then you can kill the meeting, I guess. Okay. Everybody, take care. Stay safe. Cheers. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.